You are listening to Mahogany Says Radio Show with Mahogany Silvering, mahoganysilvering.net. Tennessee's Whiskey, the number one bestseller by L. Loren. Single father Weston Daniels has built a nice life for himself and his five-year-old son. After escaping the nefarious family business, all he wants is the peace and quiet of the South and the occasional, no strings attached, roll in the hay. But destiny steps in when he meets an ebony beauty who bombards his bar. Grad student Patricia Woods is on the brink of homelessness and needs some quick cash to pay her overdue rent. A redneck bar named Whiskey's would do just the trick with its notorious bikers and flowing tips. However, when Weston's past catches up with him, he is faced with choosing between her life and the happiness he desires. Tennessee's Whiskey by best-selling author L. Loren. Available on Amazon. Get your copy today. Hot Coffee, an interracial romance by Donna R. Mercer. Roman is a playboy, but one too many scandals has put his CEO position in jeopardy. He must find a nice girl, one that the board of Hemingway Industries would approve of, and get married before the new year. Maya is just the woman he needs, with her wholesome clean image. Roman is the one man who has ever held a place in her heart, but she has no plans of marriage, only philanthropy. So Roman must prove his love and earn Kamaya's trust or risk losing it all. Everyone needs a little cream in their hot coffee. An interracial romance by Donna R. Mercer. For more information, visit www.donnarmercer.com. Hot coffee. Get your copy today. You are listening to Mahogany Says Radio Show with Mahogany Silvering, mahoganysilvering.net. Good evening, everyone, and thank you for joining us on the Mahogany Says Show. I am your host, Mahogany Silvering, and we have a great show for you tonight. Glad to be back tonight. And tonight we have author Czarina Woods. Did I say that correctly, Czarina?
Yes, you did.
Okay, just making sure. So how are you doing tonight? Good?
I'm doing good. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. So let me ask you, what prompted you to start writing and publishing?
Well, writing has always been a passion of mine. From a young girl, I always kept journals. I've always written down my feelings, my thoughts, any experiences that I've been through. I've always written them down and kept journals. And most of those journals I still have today. And so I've always knew that writing was something that I loved to do. And even in school, you know, my favorite class was English and writing papers, you know, believe it or not.
Oh, I believe that with mine too.
So I always knew that that was something that was in me. I didn't know where it would lead me or what I would do with it, but I've always known that writing has been a passion of mine.
Good. So this is your debut book, M.A.S.K, The Truth Behind the Smile. Yes. Now, are you the only author or is there another person who wrote it with you?
No, I'm the only author. I wrote this whole entire book on my own. Of course, I had, an editor who gave me tips to tweak it. I also had a project manager who helped guide me through the project to keep me on track. But this is all me. And going back to those journals, a lot of these stories and a lot of the experiences that the main character, Shelby White, goes through in this story are drawn mm-hmm. from my own personal experiences.
Ah, okay. So when did you start writing? Is it just when you were like a teenager, or did you start before?
I was always the type of child that would express myself in many ways. And my mom started buying me journals, as far as I can remember, 7 or 8 years old. So I will always keep journals. Yes, I will always keep journals and write down my feelings. Even to this day, I have journals that I just, if I'm feeling a certain way or going through a certain experience or I have certain thoughts, I will pick up my journal and write in them. And so I've been doing this from a very, very young age.
Oh, so did you always know you wanted to be a writer?
Being a writer was not the first thing that came to mind. Growing up, I always thought I would either be a teacher or a lawyer.
Okay.
But I never, it was more of a hobby, more of a way to get my feelings out. Mm-hmm. But I never saw it as it being like a career or something that I would actually do until later on in life.
Okay. So your first book is M.A.S.K. And what was that journey like when you were trying to get it published? Did you send out query letters or things like that nature?
Once the project was in draft form, since this is my debut book, I did not know where to go with it. But luckily, I had a friend who I grew up with who I remember being on the phone with her as young girls, where she would write tons and tons of stories. And I would just mm-hmm. sit on the phone with her and listen to her stories. So she has several books out, and I reached out to her when it got to the point to where it was in draft form, and just asked for her guidance. And she is the person that ended up becoming my project manager. And she walked me through the entire process, right? She walked me through the entire process. And so I ultimately ended up settling on self-publishing. And so we went through that process.
And how do you like self-publishing? Did you have any mishaps with it, or you think it was the best choice for you?
For me, I think it was the best choice just because I have that free creative space. I can do with my book what I wish as far as marketing and just having that flexibility to push my book in the direction that I feel like it should go. So it's been working well for me. Now it's more work
great.
Because you have to do more of the footwork.
Yes.
But so far it's good. More of the footwork.
Self-publishing is a little bit more involved, but it mm-hmm. I think is worth it when you can express your creativity more so, and you're not limited by, okay, it needs to go this a certain way, and I think you stay true to your story. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And that was very important to me as a writer, and especially for this story, because it's so close to my own personal experiences that it's very personal for me. And so I wanted it to remain authentic.
Yes, because only you can write your story.
Exactly.
And only you can tell your story. So, yes, I agree with you
100%. Exactly.
So,
exactly.
Have you, in the process of writing this book, did you come against any writer's block or anything like that?
I did have moments of writer's block when writing this book, but more than that, I was forced to revisit places in my life that were traumatic, that I had to kind of stop because I kind of found myself in that place, which was good because it helped me to write the story, but then it kind of evoked emotions from those specific periods of time. So it was more so of that than writer's block, where there were mm-hmm. moments I kind of had to step away and say, okay, you're not in that situation now, but
right.
It did help me get through and write the story.
Oh, that's good, because I know some things can be triggering, and especially with it being your personal story. Yeah, I can imagine how difficult that can be.
Mm-hmm.
So what, in your opinion, is the most important elements of good writing?
Good writing, I feel like you need to make sure that you're remaining true to yourself. I think oftentimes some writers write what they feel like other people want them to write. But for mm-hmm. me, I feel like the most important element is just be true to yourself. Write what you feel is authentic. Write what you feel is true to your story or whatever genre you're writing. And I would just say, don't write for anyone else. Yes, write for your readers, but make sure that you're being true and authentic to yourself when you're writing your stories.
Okay. So which came first for you? Was it the plot or the characters?
Ooh, because this is such a personal story, I would say a mixture of both. Because I
mixture
knew
both.
Who the characters were, and I definitely knew what the plot was because it was, you know, coming from my experiences. So I would say it was mm-hmm. a mixture of both.
Okay. So you consider it's kind of a fiction based on true story, would you say?
It is most definitely. Mm-hmm. Most definitely. Fictional characters, but based on true story.
Well, I really like the title that you came up with, M.A.S.K. And would you tell our listeners what M.A.S.K. stands for?
M.A.S.K. stands for Memories, Affliction, Storms, and Knowledge. And basically, I feel like in life, we all wear some type of mask. You know, your mask may be different from my mask. What's behind our mask, different. But we all mm-hmm. have a story. We all have experiences, and we've all been through things. And so that was the premise for the title of the book, just, you know, letting down your mask and working through those different experiences that you've gone through. And don't be afraid to let your mask down. Sometimes I think we do more damage to ourselves by trying to hide behind
mm-hmm.
our pain and different things that we've gone through, when it could be the most freeing experience just to let it down and let it all out.
And it also can help someone else who's afraid to let their mask down because they don't want to be judged a certain way. And when they see that someone else is being real, that's, I think, it gives other people the courage to be real as well and to be authentic to Thanks. Themselves.
So exactly.
I applaud you on that. I got goosebumps just listening to you talk about it, because it just, I mean, it's got to be an amazing journey to be able to be that open and let your, you know, let people in, because you don't know who's going to read your book and pick it up and say, hey, you know what? She did it. I could do it too.
Right. So, and that has been a lot of the feedback that I've gotten back from my readers. Like, I applaud you for being able to open up in that way. Or, you know, like you said, I have the courage now, you know, to open up about my experiences. I have people that I see that have read my book, and they're like, they want to tell me their whole story. Like, this is what I've been through, you know. So just that alone is very rewarding. And that was my goal of putting this book out.
Nice. So that's great. So you do have readers and feedback from your readers about your book. So how has it been doing so far?
So far, it's been doing good. It's been doing good. I have things in the work. COVID kind of put a stop on some things, but I'm just still working in the process of writing part two to this. So just continuing to push it out there as much as possible. It's been doing good.
Okay. So it's going to be a second part to it, or like a series, or is it along the same vein?
It's just going to be a second part because the way that the book ends, and I've had readers say this, what happened to her? You know, and so readers want to know what happened to this character. And so I feel like I need to bring her story to a close. I feel like I owe my readers that. And so I'm working on that now.
So because it was based on a lot of things that happened in your life and it's so personal to you, and so that was the most difficult part about writing it. But what is your typical writing day like? What's a typical day for you?
Well, I do work full time, and I am mommy of a 10-year-old daughter, and I'm currently expecting my second.
Oh, so, congratulations.
Thank you. And so once the day settles and everything's calm, I typically write at night. Sometimes when I'm out during the day and something may pop in my head, I'll take my phone out and write my notes. But I typically write at night when it's quiet, when I have music, soft music playing. And so that's typically my time to write.
Nice. I find it's easier, even though I don't have a full-time job, but it's easier for me to write at night. It just seems like it hits me. Yeah, most people say morning time is the best time, but I think whenever it hits you like that, you don't have a choice.
Exactly. My mornings are very busy, so I never really have time. But like I said, throughout the day, if something pops in my mind or an idea, I'll quickly take my notepad out and just jot it down so I don't lose it.
Yes, that is definitely the best way to do that. That or I record my phone, because yeah, when it strikes, you don't want to forget something like that.
Exactly.
So, would you like to have this one day as your full-time career, or is this just a second thing for you?
I do aspire to have this as a career one day, where I can even expand it further and do speaking engagements, mentoring, because the book is geared towards young women, young girls that just women in general, even, like I said, younger women as well. And so I feel like I have a story that I can share that could mentor other young girls that are going through similar situations, or if they know someone that has gone through similar situations, and help them get through that, you know, even as far as if starting a nonprofit to help young girls that have gone through similar situations. So I definitely see that in the future.
Oh, yes. I think that would be really good. So that would be like another platform for you to really reach out and use your book as to kind of a way to even maybe start teaching a little bit, or, you know, have speaking engagements for young women.
Exactly.
So,
and to encourage them, you know,
yes,
a lot of times
girls
feel like, right, they feel like they're alone in their situations, but just knowing, hey, that this person is here and they understand my struggles and they understand what I'm going through, I feel like, you know, sometimes that's all a person needs. And so I definitely think that that's something that will most definitely happen in the future.
Well, that's good. So has writing been emotionally draining or stressful in any way for you as you were writing this book?
There were times where it was emotionally draining, just because, again, it's from personal experiences. And anytime you have to go back through those experiences, it can be emotionally draining. Not saying that it was all bad. There were times, you know, where things were good throughout the time periods that I tell in this story. But it was an emotionally draining process, but it was rewarding. And it was therapeutic, believe it or not. And so at the end of it, I was like, wow, you know, look how much junk or stuff that I released just from writing the story. You know, it was like a weight was lifted off of me. And so it was definitely a freeing experience to write it. So having to go through those different emotions was worth it at the end.
Definitely. So do you have any tips for aspiring writers now that you have published your first book?
I would say, again, just write, be true to yourself in your writing. Don't allow other people's influences to change your direction. If you have a vision for where you feel like you want your story to go, then stick to that. You know, the editing and all of that will come later, but enjoy the writing process. Just be free in your writings. When I wrote, I didn't write in a particular order. I just wrote what I felt, because the book also includes original poetry for me. And so whatever I felt, I just wrote. And, you know, the rest will come together later. So I would just tell any aspiring writers, just be free in your writing and don't try to make it perfect the first go round. Just write whatever comes to mind.
True. It's just get it out and then you can worry about the editing later, because that is not my favorite part, editing.
Hey, it's a process, right?
It is a process, definitely. So what is your favorite part or least favorite part of the whole process of writing and then publishing?
Probably, the editing, it was a process because you had to go back through several rounds of it. There were some unexpected things that happened in the end when it came to actually publishing through Amazon. There were a lot of hiccups with the system. So towards the end, and it happened like a week before my release date. So even with the image, the book cover itself, and just things that the Amazon was kicking back out, you know, as far as formatting. So it was like the 11th hour of trying to get things resolved. So that part was a bit frustrating at the end, but it was things that was out of our control. But we got it worked out, so it worked out well. But just that part towards the end was a bit frustrating. Okay. But the writing itself, I enjoyed.
Well, that's good. So we know there's a second book in the works. So what would you say in this book, was there any characters that really stands out to you that became like a favorite?
My favorite character in the book is Samantha, who is Shelby White's mother. She is my favorite character in the book because she is centered around my own personal mother. And she just shows a tremendous amount of strength for herself, for her kids. And, you know, when you read the book, you will see their relationship, the dynamic of their relationship, and how they have highs and they have lows. Samantha had Shelby when she was 17 years old, so they pretty much grew up together.
And so, nice.
Right. So just seeing their relationship just blossom and that mother-daughter bond, it's amazing. And so Samantha is my favorite character in the book.
Nice. So when you started writing it, and you went through some of the things that you were, you know, triggered with, but was it, okay, how can I say this? Was it so emotional when you were trying to separate the fact that you're not in it, but you're writing the characters based on what you went through? Okay.
Was it so emotional?
Yeah,
I'm
was
sorry.
It so emotional that sometimes you couldn't, you know, you had to like stop, put it down, walk away?
Oh, yes, most definitely. Shelby White went through a lot of traumatic things in this book. Her father was addicted to drugs and alcohol. So seeing that at a young age in her household, she was raped when she was 14, you know, so going through that experience. So, yes, most definitely writing those stories, I did have to step away from it for a moment, and then, but I immediately got back to it just because I wanted to use those emotions to translate in the book. And so that readers can really understand what Shelby was going through when she was experiencing those things.
And probably really sometimes relate as well if they've experienced something similar.
Exactly.
So, do you listen to music while you were writing?
Yes. I listen to music that I remember from those periods of time. So if I was writing something that happened in the 90s, and I'm like, you know, this song was playing. And even throughout the book, I'll mention certain songs like, oh, this is playing in the background. I would literally play those songs while I wrote those specific chapters or scenes. So, yes, most definitely music calms me. So, yes, I listen to music all the time.
Yes, I think so, too, especially when I'm writing it, depending, even no matter what it is, it's just kind of gets me going, especially if I'm writing a chase scene or whatever. I might listen to something like rap or even rock, depending on the type of scene I'm writing, because it really kind of gets, you know, for me, like getting into your headspace as if you're watching a movie. Do you think that's one of your goals, that you would like maybe one day to see this book on film?
Oh, yes, most definitely. I can envision it. I've even heard people say that book should be a movie. So, yes, I most definitely see that. I think it would be a great story on the movie screen. And I think a lot of people would be able to relate to it. So, most definitely.
Well, good. Hopefully they will open at the theaters after we get over all this stuff.
I know.
It's been weird not being able to go to the movies. Yeah. Some places are, but not here. Everything's still been strictly on the TV, and you pay for it, you know, through your cable provider, but it's just not the same.
Especially missing the popcorn at the movie theater.
Yes, right. It's like you can't find that popcorn anywhere. It has to be from the theater.
Exactly, that butter. I know I'm missing it.
Yeah.
For sure.
I know it is really not good for you, but it tastes so good on that popcorn.
It does. And the nachos. I know, I'm getting hungry just thinking about it.
I know, just, right? You can like taste the popcorn.
Exactly.
So speaking of movies, what do you do when you're not writing? What things do you do for fun or hobbies?
Oh, well, right now, like I said, I have a 10-year-old who keeps me very busy. She's in dance and school. But when I'm not doing that, I love being around my family. So anything that's family-oriented, you know, whether that's my mom doesn't live in the state. She lives in Maryland. Mm-hmm. So whether that's me going to visit her or we just get together for family gatherings. I love movies, so I'm always watching movies. So just anything relaxing that I can do. I was taking cycling at one point, so I would do cycling classes, yoga.
Ooh,
so
more power to you.
Anything that kind of
cycling.
Yes, it's no joke. It's no joke.
No,
but it was like a hip hop cycling class, so
cool.
Was really upbeat. So, but anything that kind of allows me to relax or burn off some energy. And that's what I'll be doing in my time.
Okay. So what was your dream job when you were younger?
When I was younger, being either a teacher or a lawyer. I always was like, I want to be a middle school teacher. And I actually went to college for teaching, but ended up changing my major at the last minute. But it was either a lawyer or a teacher. That was always what I wanted to do. And it had to be an English teacher because I like writing.
Exactly.
Didn't want to do anything else but English. But yeah, those were my dream jobs.
Well, you still can. I mean, you can have seminars and help other writers as well as, you know, young women that read your book. And yeah, you do different things like that. That's still teaching, technically. even though it may not be middle school, but I'm still teaching it away.
Which is probably a good reason, good thing that I didn't, because now with this homeschooling, I'm like, whew, I'm glad I'm not a teacher right now. I am kind of sort of.
I did homeschooling for 6 years, and yeah, it's a lot. I was not their teacher. They had their own teachers, but it was still just, you know, getting them to get through their lessons each day and, you know, the one-on-one with their teachers and then, you know, just, but they're, everybody's still home. And so we tried to get out, we tried to go on our little field trips here and there so that kind of break up things. So, but with everything being closed, I'm pretty sure, you know, people who were home, had to homeschool, they're just like, I don't see how people would do this.
No, but I give teachers props because you have to have a special patience to do their job. So I really, really do give them props for what they do.
Yes, because it is, you know, every student does not learn the same way. They really don't.
Exactly.
Some are better if you show them what to do, and some are better if you just, you can give them directions and they got it. But other people are like, nope, you just sit down with me and point this out. So.
Exactly, exactly. And when you have a mixture of that in your class, you know, I'm sure that can be testing at times.
Yeah, and I had three kids, and they were in all different age groups. So.
Oh, wow.
The eldest one
was
middle school, one was elementary, and then one was kindergarten. So, in the kindergarten, you had to sit there with them and go over, and it was repetitive. I was like, I have to hand it to kindergarten teachers. They do a lot. They really
well, my
do.
Hat is off to you, too. You juggled that, so.
Oh, yeah, between each one trying to get it together.
Oh, wow.
Because the one finishes early, and then they're bored, and I was like, oh, hey, will you go do this, and I'll finish up. You know, we'll finish it, sit here, and I'll finish it with the little one. The little one was usually done before everybody else. Because he had to make sure he knew his numbers. So I'd make everything a game because it was just the only way he could, you know, pick it up sometimes. Because I knew he was looking at me like, I don't want to do this.
Exactly.
At that age, you know, you go to kindergarten and have friends and play with, you know, play on the playground. And so, yeah, he was like,
Exactly. I understand. Well, fortunately, my daughter works pretty well independently. She has those moments where she's like, Mommy, I need your help. And I'm like, okay, you know. But for the most part, she's pretty good with doing her work on her own. So that's been helpful.
Well, yes. So have you guys started back to school yet?
Yes. This is her second week back. So we have been completely virtual for 2 weeks now.
Ah, okay. Well, we had half and half here. So my son chose to, of course, go back to campus because he's like, nope, we're not, I'm not staying home anymore. I had it for 6 years. I'm done.
He needs to get out, huh? Be around his peers.
He's playing football. So, yes.
Oh, okay.
And I was like, it's kind of strange because, you know, the coaches have the mask and stuff and, you know, the boys have their uniform, their helmets and everything. And I'm like, so how is that going to be social distancing when you've got to, you know, we're sitting in the bleachers all sitting apart.
but they
need something, you know. We can't just, like, totally stop their life. So
exactly. I was just going to say that. They do. They need that outlet.
Yes. And they get new masks every time they go into the building. They have hand sanitizer right there. So they are constantly, you know, every time they walk through the hall, they it's mandatory to wear that mask. And even in the classroom, sometimes they can, you know, the students are spaced out, so they're not very close to each other. So at that point, they could kind of take the mask down. But as soon as they go out in the hallway, they got to put it back on. So I think the schools are pretty good about following protocol. And then the other half are the students who decided to stay home and they do the online learning. So.
Okay.
It's good that they have.
Well, that's good. I'm sure that's comforting for you.
He's so tall. Big kid. And he is. He's a good kid. He's like, he's almost 6'2", I want to say, because I definitely have to look up. But look, just because you're up there, I still got you down here. So.
Right. Exactly.
But, you know, you're getting ready to be really busy with your new baby, so.
Oh, I know.
So when are you
I'm ready. I'm due in December.
Okay. Yeah, you got a few months then. Okay. So then
I have a little time.
You got a little time, so you can maybe get the second book out, and then, you know, by the time the baby's born, then you can have, you know, because you're going to want that time with them. You know, that first 6 weeks.
Exactly.
All that bonding time.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, I wouldn't trade that for the world.
Right. Yeah. And my goal is to get the second book out before she arrives. So you're
also,
right, because that
girl.
Bonding
okay.
time is very. It is. Yes, it's another girl.
Aww.
So I'm definitely looking forward to that bonding time. So I want to make sure they both have my undivided attention.
Yes, because that can, you know, be too difficult when you have more than one kid, you know. And they all have different needs.
Exactly.
And so you're the 10 years mm-hmm. apart. So that's a, you know, she might be, you know, babysitter sometime. As the baby grows. She might say, okay, you know. Right
exactly.
now, she's a little doll to her, you know. So it's like, oh,
Ray's
cute.
Right.
You're cute.
Until she starts running her room, huh? Going in her room.
Oh, yes.
Taking over her stuff.
She starts walking around. Yes. And come get her. Mom.
Right. Exactly. Exactly. So I'm looking forward to it.
Oh, that's good. And it's always good to, you know, get new life coming in. And it's been a rough year, so it's good to hear that, you know, when life goes on. There's been so many things happening this year, it's great to see that. But it's, you know, life continues. We keep going. We keep growing. We keep striving. We keep moving forward. So no matter what. And I honestly think maybe another year before everything kind of settles down, because when people learn how to settle down and stop running out without the mask.
Exactly. Or is our new norm, you know? I'm trying
right,
to see if we're going to go back to what we consider normal.
Yeah, because everyone is, you know, just used to going out and doing things. And, you know, everything came to a halt for a little while. But then, you know, they
exactly.
found other ways to do things. But I think here in the United States, we're probably the worst country about keeping to that, because everybody was so tired of being home that just, I think some governors opened things up prematurely.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah,
and the numbers went up. Because even, you know, especially here in Georgia, they went up. Like the first thing people did, stand in line to get tennis shoes. And I thought, why?
Mm-hmm. I thought,
where are you?
Well.
You know, it's like, what are you going to do with some tennis shoes? You can't even go anywhere.
Right.
Right.
Everything's closed, right?
Yes.
Oh.
So, who
I
worked on the cover?
Too.
I'm sorry. Who worked on the cover for your book?
My project manager had a contact, and so we actually worked together on the cover. I had a vision, and we both, you know, kind of ran ideas by one another, and so this is the result of that. I knew that I wanted an actual mask, and I knew that mm-hmm. I wanted somebody holding it, and so that's how we came up with the cover for the book.
Okay, nice. Well, it definitely fits in and ties in with the story, so I think they did a great job. That's why I asked. It's like, this is a great cover.
Right. And I also wanted it to appear, you know, you don't really know who's behind the mask, because, again,
mm-hmm.
we all wear them and we don't really let them down. And so
right.
that was my vision for the cover.
Nice. So I will open up the lines. And if anyone wants to call in and ask questions, you can call 914-205-5632. And press number one if you would like to ask any questions of Ms. Czarina Woods, who is the author that we have been talking with. And if you're just joining us, we have been talking about her book, her debut book, M.A.S.K, The Truth Behind the Smile. And tell us one more time what M.A.S.K stands for.
MASK stands for Memories, Afflictions, Storms, and Knowledge.
Nice. Memories, Afflictions, Storms, and Knowledge. That's good. I like that.
Yes. Thank you.
So congratulations, and this is your first book, and I look forward to seeing more from you and getting to know you for this interview. It seems like you've got things well in hand, and you're just going to be awesome with all of this. And you've got two little girls who are going to just, like, they have a mom that has so much that experience that she could give and impart, and wisdom that she can impart to them. So there you go, right off the bat.
Right. Thank you so much. I really, really appreciate that, and I receive that. And, yes, I most definitely hope that my experiences will be able to help guide them through different experiences that they're going to go through in life as well. So,
yes. So do you have a website or anything like that or other social media that listeners can look for you and your books?
I can be found on Facebook, author Czarina Woods. I can also be found on Instagram at author Czarina Woods. My book is currently on Amazon only. I do have some things in the works, so it may be available somewhere else pretty soon. But right now it is available on Amazon.
And it's in paperback
and,
as well?
Paperback and ebook.
Okay. You got both platforms. Good. Well, you know what? Even you may even consider an audiobook.
I've thought about that. I have thought about it, and I've looked into it a little bit. But mm-hmm. that is something that I do feel like is next on the list, to make it an audiobook.
Yes, because that way, you know, some people who like to listen to audiobooks, I think that's just like the next wave. But it can be, you know, for, like I said, people learn different ways. And sometimes hearing mm-hmm. the story affects people too. So that maybe
that's
they can
true.
Read it, but, you know, but sometimes when we hear something, we retain it. So that's why I think it's good to have all three platforms, where they can have the ebook, or they can pick it up as a paperback, or, you know, have the option of listening to it as well. Is there,
right.
is that, I think, brings in
any
people who, yeah, who don't read, you know, or who don't have time to sit down and read, but they can listen to it in their car on the way to work or wherever.
Right, I agree. And if you have any recommendations,
you know,
please let me know.
I used ACX. They're really good, and they have a contract with audiblebooks.com, so that really works well to get, and you have a choice of, you know, auditioning people to narrate your book.
Okay.
And I like how they
okay.
have so many different people that, and you actually can choose who you would like to narrate your book, so that you have a say so in that, because you want to have this finished product and someone who embodies that character for you that can really tell the story. So I really like that, and it's affordable there. They don't charge a whole lot, and there's even ways where you can split royalties with the narrator. So there's all different
oh, wow.
options that they have for doing it. So if you want to look into them, they are part of, I think it's acx.com, and if you go on there, they have a link with audio, so with audiobooks. So for people who subscribe already, it goes automatically on that website. So when people subscribe, your book will be right along with everyone else's. So you already have a market.
Okay. Okay, nice. Thank you so much for that information.
You're welcome.
I sure will. Thank you.
Because I enjoyed my experience with mine, and I think, you know, it wasn't as challenging as I thought it was going to be.
Really?
I
you know, when
guess.
I think audio, I do think, oh, yeah, okay. But it
yes,
wasn't challenging.
I've heard some that are like, what were they thinking? Because I know there's different companies that, you know, do it. It's not just one. But everyone that I've heard that has done through Audible.com and ACX, have really good narrators to where you can get into the story and they're engaging and not just, you know, reading. You know what I mean? It's like you're there with them and you're experiencing the story as you're listening to it.
Right, and that's very important.
Yes.
I feel, especially with an audio book. You want someone that's going to evoke those emotions and put the reader in the place of the character. So, or in the place of where the character is. So I do think that's very important.
Mm-hmm. It is most definitely. Because I think it's like the next frontier, I guess. But you still have, because there's lots of e-readers and there's lots of book readers, but then there's also people who don't always have the time to read. But if they hear it's on audiobook, they'll pick it up and listen to it. So then you gain another reader. So I think it's just another way of opening up to spreading out to where you have more people have access to it.
Well, thank you for the information. I most definitely will look into it.
You're welcome. Anytime. As I learn different things from interviewing people, and that's why I get their opinions and, you know, things that they kind of went through with publishing, because everybody's story is different. So, you know, you can kind of take from that. And it also helps other people listening who may have thought about doing it and weren't so sure, or now that they've seen that you've done it and they're like, okay, well, I could do this too. So,
Right.
Especially for the topic of your book. So. Yeah.
Right. Yeah, it's not as bad as you think. You know, at first, when I first started, I was like, oh my gosh, this is going to be a lot, you know, to write, to publish. But once I really got into the process, it wasn't as bad as I thought it was going to be, or as difficult as I thought it was going to be. It really was not a bad process.
So how is the marketing going for you? Because I know sometimes that can be a challenge in itself.
It is a challenge. It is a challenge, especially when you're self-publishing. You have to market yourself. And so, and then again, once I published my book, it was like right before COVID hit. And so it was like I had things set up and then things got canceled. And then so now it's kind of I'm trying to pick up a bit more now that things are opening up and things of that nature. So it was just the timing of everything for me that kind of threw things off a bit. But I'm picking it back up now. But it is a challenge because I'm not a marketer. Marketing is not my strength. But, you know, I do a lot of research. I have mentors. I have people that I talk to. And so I've just been doing it that way, networking and things of that nature. So,
yes, because there's lots of groups, author groups, things that people will even promote for you. Like I will promote for you because I have a page now that I can, you know, promote all of the authors that come on the show and really, you know, get them to start, you know, seeing all the different books that are out there and all the new authors that are coming around so that it also engages them more. And they're like, oh, I didn't know that. So, you know, okay, I found a new book. So I think there's quite a few promoters too that are you'll find on Facebook as well. Unique Words is one of them, and there's a lot to, you know, people that help with not just editing, but you have a little group already. But just for the on the promotion side of it, there is a website called allauthor.com, and they help with a lot of your promotions, especially. They have banners you can use to help promote your books. They have, actually, you can set up your Twitter account with them, and they will tweet for you, so you're not sitting there all day trying to say, okay, I've got to spend an hour on this one and on that one, between Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. And it kind of takes the guesswork out of it for you. So, and it's okay. Like a really low price, and you get 6 months to a year with them, and you can extend it each one. You know, each time, and they really do push you and promote you, and they have contests for your book covers, and it also gives you more exposure. So, and for the price, I think it's you know, it's worth everything because it frees me up from having to sit on Twitter and constantly send out tweets about my book when they have it set up on automatic and they tweet for you. And there's a few others that, you know, are promoting. And I think the cheapest one I found was, and it's called Author Week. And they also do promotions for you and on their websites and on different websites where they have lots of traffic. So, and in the lowest one, the smallest package was like $20 or something, and it was for a month. So it's really not, if you can find things like that, it makes it easier for self-publishers, you know, so that you can get, you know, more for your money instead of shelling out, you know, a lot and not getting any response from it. And you can gauge. And have you done any author takeovers on Facebook groups?
I have not done that yet. I've seen them, but I haven't done that yet.
Well, there's several groups. I'll send you the links to some that are specifically for promotion. And they have, it's where you can sign up for different groups. And they are takeover games on Pinterest. Pinterest will be huge for you because that's where I got primarily most of my games, where they're engage your readers. And the more the readers get to know you, the more, you know, and if you don't, I offer free ebooks, or I also do something like an Amazon gift card in like $5, $3, whatever, so that they can order the books. So, you know, so it gives you more exposure and you get more people who will start following you and they'll start talking to their friends and, you know, so just so on and so on. You'll get shared more. So that will get you more promotions for your book. Especially since this is new, this is your first book, and you want to get as much promotion. There's so many readers, but there's so many groups that they can, that will help, you know, push you forward and increase your sales. Because now more people start knowing more about you. Because that's the biggest thing is like, you know, okay, so I wrote this book and now it's published. But nobody knows it exists, you know, so you have to really push.
Right.
I found a really great group. There's another readers of Black romance. There's all kinds of groups. There's even a Black Authors Network, and they help each other and give you like resources and everything. So I also try to post weekly about different resources that I find to help other authors, because when I got into it, it was a lot of work and trial and error. Mm-hmm. So if I can help somebody else avoid certain things, it's a lot easier for you. So you don't have the headache that I had when I had to do it. So.
Right. Well, I appreciate all the information that you've given me. It's definitely helpful. And as far as the groups, I have joined a lot of groups. That's how I've been able to get a lot of the interviews and my book cover in some of the magazines. So, yes, it is a lot of work, but I definitely appreciate the information you've given me. It's definitely going to be helpful.
Yes, and I'll send you those links, okay, as well, so you can see, you know, especially for, you know, so you can have your author takeovers, and because they're really fun to do, and it's like the fun part of promotion. It makes promotion fun, because I know a lot of people are like, promoting, and it's kind of this, you know, you seize up with fear, like, okay, how do I press my book? And so I think it makes it easier. And, you know, even the kids can sit down with you and play games.
Help out.
Yeah, see. So we still have a few minutes. And if anyone would like to call in again, the number is 914-205-5632. And we are talking with Czarina Woods on her debut book, M.A.S.K, The Truth Behind the Smile. So I'm going to do a little commercial break for a second here, and then we'll come right back.
Okay.
From author Mahogany Silver Rain comes the book, Tell Me You Love Me. Tell Me You Love Me is a paranormal and diverse romance novella. This is the first book in the Kenya Clark series. Breaking the laws of magic, a supernatural serial killer is unleashed on the city of Atlanta, Georgia. Special Agent Kenya Clark of the GBI Paranormal Crimes Investigation Unit has been given the case. Her partner hates anything to do with the supernatural. Kenya has a gift that allows her to see the crime through the eyes of the victim. However, in this case, she sees through the eyes of the killer. To solve the case, she must find out where her connection to the killer is. But will she and her partner be able to work together? Tell Me You Love Me from author Mahogany Silver Rain is available on Amazon in both Kindle and paperback editions, as well as the author's website, mahoganysilverrain.net. Tell Me You Love Me from author Mahogany Silver Rain. Order your copy today.
And we are back. We are talking with author Czarina Woods and her debut novel, M.A.S.K, The Truth Behind the Smile. And so tell me, your follow-up book, do you have a title for it yet?
I do not have it yet. It will be titled M.A.S.K, but I'm not sure what the subtitle will be just yet.
Okay. So then we'll find out more what happens to Shelby.
Yes, yes, you will. Most definitely. It has been highly requested. So you will most definitely see what else
good
happens
thing.
To her.
That means they really like the book and they're like, wait, I'm invested now. What happened? So,
right.
That's always
exactly.
A good thing.
Right, right. So I'm excited. Just starting to write part two has been very exciting for me. So I'm excited to hear what readers are going to think about her, the remaining of her story.
Okay. And it gives you a little more confidence when you're writing the second one because you have people who are like, you know, they're waiting for it.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Every time I think about putting my pen down or stop typing, I'm like, but wait, somebody just said what happened to her. So I have to keep going, you know. So
mm-hmm.
I know they're waiting for it.
So when you're writing, do you typically go by an hour, or it just depends on how much time you actually have to write?
It just depends on the time and what's going on around me. But I try to set aside, you know, a good amount of time to get out what I can, especially if it's something that's been on my mind that particular day. And I'm like, okay, I got to get home and write this. So I try to, while the fire is going, I try to keep it going, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So I just write. I try not to put myself on like a schedule when I'm writing because I feel like that adds additional pressure.
Yes.
But I just write, you know, what I feel. And if that means I only get a page out that day, then I just get a page out that day. So I try not to be too hard on myself.
Oh, that's good. That's good because, yeah, sometimes when you mm-hmm. have to be on deadline, that's another cool thing about being self-published, that you don't have this, okay, well, we need you to have this book done by such and such time, and you're struggling to try to meet that deadline because
mm-hmm.
you have a full-time job, you got babies, you know, and it makes that's pressure. And then when,
exactly.
you know, you think you're finished and then you've got rounds with the editor back and forth and like, okay, and they keep sending it back to you. So, yeah.
Right. Exactly.
So,
and in the pressure, I feel like it takes away from the, you know, I want it to be good quality story.
Yeah.
So sometimes
exactly.
that pressure can kind of mess with the quality
overshadow.
Of the book. So.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly. Well, thank you for coming on the show tonight. And I look forward to seeing the second book, but I got to finish reading the first one. But yeah, I'll be looking for what happened because I read and then I get invested and I'm like, okay, I got to know. But thank you so much for coming on the show. And when the second one comes, let me know and I can bring you back on and we'll talk about that one. How about that?
That sounds good. And thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate it.
You're welcome. Anytime. Thank you so much. And I want to wish everyone a good evening. And I wish you blessings, peace, and love.
You are listening to Mahogany Says Radio Show. with Mahogany Silverane. MahoganySilverane.net. Listening to Mahogany Says with Mahogany Silverane at MahoganySilverane.net. Thank you and good night.